Welcome to the joint Calexico City Council and Heffernan Memorial Healthcare District Special Meeting. Today is Monday, March 6th at 5:39 PM. Roll call. Here.
Here.
Yes. Hector Valdez.
Councilman Hodge, would you lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance, please?
Stand. Ready, begin. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Announcements. These proceedings may be viewed on the City of Calexico website at www.calexico.ca.gov the Friday following after City Council meeting, public comments, and public appearances. Note, not to exceed 3 minutes. This is the time of the public to address City Council on items on the special agenda, items only. The mayor will recognize you when you come to the microphone. Please state your name and place of residence for the record. While members of the public are encouraged to participate, it is unlawful to disturb or delay the council meeting with personal or slanderous remarks. City Council is prohibited by state law from taking action or discussing items not included on the printed agenda. Please direct your questions and comments to the City Council. Do we have public comments? It's the other one. That one's the one that works. Okay,
yeah. Good afternoon, council and board members from the Heffernan Memorial Board. My name is Leti Zuno. I am at 428 Washington Street, Calexico. I'm here to thank you all for being in this joint meeting on behalf of the citizens of Calexico that have entrusted me to come forth and bring their message to you in making sure that I'm pleading to you that our fire department stay as it is, one of you described it to me as recently as last week, is that in the current staffing condition that it is, you called it mediocre at best. That was coming from a council member. So if you have currently what you have as in terms of staffing, and this was just in terms of staffing, this was not directed at the quality of service that the fire department brings to the city. In terms of the staffing, it was described as mediocre at best by a council member. So I'm here again pleading on behalf of the residents of Calexico that you take this opportunity to work together, as you've already demonstrated that you're willing to do. Heffernan Board, thank you so much on behalf of myself and the voice of people of Calexico. We appreciate you coming forth to the table and working with our leaders of the City of Calexico to resolve the issue if it's an inability to pay. Thank you so much for stepping to the board and offering that level of solution. All we can hope for is that we continue to see this level of governance, because I think Calexico definitely deserves it. I think you've all shown an exemplary level of professionalism in working together and bringing this meeting to fruition. So I'm here to thank you, and I'm here to see this to the end. So we hope to see something positive come out of this. Thank you so much.
Do you have a motion to approve the agenda? Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Moving to discussion of potential action items. Item number one, discussion or action regarding overall emergency services within the City of Calexico. I believe we're going to call.
Yeah. Can I first say that there were some concerns about us being able to finance or help out with the fire department, especially with LAFCO. That's the organization that we have to respond to. So I asked Mr. Renison if he would do me the favor and go over there today. And I would like for him to come to the podium and be able to relate what you told me and tell it to the audience. Mr. Renison, please.
Yeah,
Yeah, good evening, Honorable City Council and Hospital Board. The Executive Director of LASCO states that you are able to provide the fire department with the monies you have spoken about. You are not able to enter into a ambulance service as a board or as a district. That would have to go through a lot of steps. But yes, you are allowed to grant that money to the fire department. And I'm also waiting for a call from Ryan Childers, who's their attorney. But as far as I'm concerned, that's the gospel truth.
Thank you, Mr. Renderson.
Thank you. So I guess we'll start with City Manager.
So Mr. Mayor and board members, City Council, I thought I would start, and members of the public, I'm sorry, I would start by kind of overviewing why we're here. I put a sheet of paper that has a couple of slides, and I put some more copies up there for the public. But if you recall, back in June and July of last year, when your City Council approved the budget, you approved the budget with a $3.9 million placeholder to direct the city manager to cost savings throughout the year. And that's how the budget was approved and adopted. Over the last 7 months, our city staff has been negotiating with several union groups, and we've also took the task to try to find ways to reduce that $3.9 million budget. And we've identified and put together a plan for you at our meeting in September, and how to best go about achieving those $3.9 million savings. And if you look at the slide number 7, which is the first slide on the piece of paper I just gave you, we were able to restore some of the fees that were temporarily reduced. And we went out and got some traffic grants, negotiated employee contract concessions with the CMEA, the miscellaneous groups here at City Hall, mid-management, unrepresented employees, and also the City Council. You did also agree to some concessions, which more important is you took away your medical plan. We've also identified vacancies that we wouldn't hire back to achieve savings, and we deferred the equipment replacement, and we also went line by line and talked to department heads about reducing their operating expenses. And we are down to the very last $568,224 that we need to save to be able to close the budget gap. We have been trying to negotiate with the Fire Association to try to see if there's any appetite for them to offer some concessions, just like the other groups have done. And at this point, we've reached a point when there hasn't been any negotiations. Consequently, we have, at this point, since there's only less than 3.5 months to achieve the savings that you directed me to do, we've decided to to exercise our management rights, which will be to reduce levels of services in order to achieve the cost savings. We have sent the association a letter indicating how we propose to cost to close the budget gap. Again, it's $568,224, and it would cost us to have to lay off 6 firefighters, and that's sort of the reason why we're here today. I would be happy to answer any questions you may have at this point.
I have a question. What entails the $568,000 infraction? What is exactly what it is? Is salaries that we owe, or is we gonna have to pay? What is it exactly?
So what? How we proposed to close the budget gap was a combination of several things. Some of those were line item reductions, and approximately $2.4 million worth of that was salary concessions and benefit concessions from all the union groups. We have proposed for all, just about all the groups, that they help the city achieve the cost savings through several steps. One of them was a salary reduction, a voluntary salary reduction. We asked the employee groups to help us pay for some of the benefits they receive. For example, some of the groups have agreed to pay 20% of the medical benefits. Some other groups have agreed to pay a higher percentage. We've also asked the employee groups to assist us with their portion of the retirement. And when you put them all together, we've actually been able to achieve a lot of savings through that. We proposed the CFA, the Firefighter Association, to do the same in a combination of several things that they can save us, or they can help us save those $568,000.
I have a question for you, Mr. Villa. I know that it's been repeated many, many times before that the fire department is the only one that has not taken any type of a reduction, the 30% or 35% that you're requesting. Are there any other groups in your bargaining unit that have not taken?
Yeah, there's two other groups that we are actually negotiating. I don't want to talk too much about negotiations, but there's two other groups that we have actually reached an impasse with, and we will be implementing reductions.
An impasse means that you can't come to an agreement.
That's right.
And you have to go to a mediator.
Correct.
So there are two other groups, you don't need to mention their names, I don't want to know, that you still have not reached. So the fire department is not the only one that you have not finished doing negotiations. There are two other groups, right?
That's correct.
Okay. Thank you. I do have a question. You just mentioned now that exercising management rights is what you're doing now to basically declare the fiscal crisis. So I don't want to get too much into the steps of negotiations either, but I recall that we did attach a portion of our municipal code that substantiates this type of action when there is a crisis. Now, is it a management right, or is there actually a process that a municipality such as ourselves has to follow when you're going to take that type of extreme declaration? Because we all know that a lot of our concerns and our differences right now are the level of accuracy or the level of production of sufficient financial information to move forward with negotiations. And so because of that, it's a little confusing where that stands, if you can address that a little bit. Sorry, I have a really bad cold.
We haven't declared a crisis. What we have declared is that we lack funds to close the budget gap. Under the rules and regulations that the city has adopted, the personnel rules and regulations, there's a provision that allows the city to approach the unions and invoke the lack of funds, a provision to cost savings. And it allows management to take more rigid steps to achieve those savings, some of which are reduction in services or reduction in force, which is what one of the things that we're doing.
I guess what it is what defines the fiscal crisis, and who defines it, and what processes or protocols are followed when a city is using that status for the closure of a service such as this.
We are not declaring a fiscal crisis. We are saying we lack the funds to close the budget gap. As it has been documented in several meetings that we've had with the council, presentations that we've done, is our budget right now is out of whack. We are spending more money than comes in, and we need to be able to close that gap. For 2016-17, we've identified that we were short $3.9 million. We have done a series of things to be able to reduce that number to just about $600,000 now that we need.
Well, you know, closure of a fire department on that side, and in the circumstances that we're in, of course, it's very severe, and crucial that we take a moment and then realize that that is the only alternative, and that if we are declaring a fiscal crisis, then in fact we can support that, because I know that, again, that's where our differences are, I guess, with the city, within a lot of our unions and the community itself, that we feel that these decisions are being made with not sufficient information to substantiate it, I guess. So it's just a little concern where, you know, there's a lot of different also opinions of what occurs elsewhere within the city that may contradict the fiscal crisis being declared. So I just wanted to express that. I don't know if there's anything else that we could say about that, but if this is a decision that's going to affect so many people, that there be a process in which a city can declare that and have everyone aware. Because if we are, in fact, then going to be taking these measures, I think we caught the community off guard, pretty much, with what the activity has been going on, and that this happened all of a sudden, and that the core of the issue is still the financial presentation of information. That's my comment.
I wanted to find out a little bit more. I want to ditto on what Norma was saying about the $568,000. This is all on the fire department. This is all salaries, or what does this entitle? What's inside the 500? What expenses are there?
So we requested. We gave the unions, all the associations, the alternative of choosing a menu of options, some of which were salaries plus benefits, mm-hmm. right? And some of the unions have chosen to take entirely 100% of the required concessions through salaries, such as the police department. Some other unions have chosen to help the city pay for their medical insurance, for their retirement, and also take...
No, Mr. Villa, that's not what I'm asking for. What I want to know is the $568,000, what is it? Is it all salaries, or what expenses? Yeah, but
we,
this
we are,
total.
We are.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. They gave them options.
Okay. Did you understand?
That's correct.
Well, Mr. Villa, I have a question. What about next year? So this $568,000, you know, you're trying to cut for this fiscal year, right? But if they, let's say they take all the cut in salaries or any option that you gave them, right? Is that going to stay like that next year? Is this the planned budget for next year?
We're only talking about the amount that we need to be able to close the budget for June 30th.
I understand
that. We haven't talked about any negotiations for next year, although some unions have agreed to concessions next year.
Okay, I guess my question is that if the $568,000 are reduced, the way you are planning to plan your budget for next year, is that going to be without or with those salaries, with those salary cuts? Or
I didn't understand the question. Can you ask it again, please?
Yes,
sir.
I believe what Mr. Martinez wants to say is, let's say that Heffernan agreed, in my opinion, to pay $568,000 and then that is going to be the part that is needed for this fiscal year, to close this fiscal year. What about the next one? Are you willing to negotiate with Heffernan, either half and half, or are you going to be able to sustain or pay the complete salaries from the fire department? That's my question.
Well,
It's
kind of a difficult question, only because we haven't begun our budget process for next year, for next fiscal year. We intend to begin the budget process with the council in April, and we start allocating resources to the departments. Right now, we're talking about how to close the budget gap to June 30th, 2017.
Another thought that I can add to you. In in the event that Heffernan agrees to subsidize half of that $250,000 for the next fiscal year, the city will be able to work better, at least for the next year, just to make sure that the firemen we need are going to be able to continue.
I think that goes without saying, yes. And any type of grant funding or any type of funding that we get extra from what we usually get is only going to make our budget picture better next year.
Just trying to make sure that we have our fire people working with the city and have the station too that is much needed, because I'm working in a program that is designated to treat people with addiction. And I see these people all the time picking those addictions when they are some overdose, some sick, and they need medical attention like that. Believe me, I've seen that almost daily.
We're not here debating whether they provide a service or not. I think they provide a fine service, exactly. A very needed service. It's just that what we have a very difficult, challenging fiscal year, and you know, there's a lot of things that are coming up due to the city, and we need to find a way to reduce costs to make sure they align with our expenditures or our revenues. Our revenues continue to be pretty steady. What has hurt the city is a combination of a whole bunch of things that deal with revenue generation. Big part of it is retail sales. The peso devaluation has hurt the city a lot. Every year, you know, revenues have been declining 5 to 10%, and you know, we have had some really difficult times with our pension plan, where CalPERS continues to ask for more contribution to the city. So that's a big hit to the city that we need to find a way to balance that.
I think that one of the things that our board is kind of concerned. We're concerned that we're willing to give the money. I mean, at least I think it's what I hear from everybody. But it's not, we don't want it to become a habit. We don't want for it to say, well, Hefferman's going to give us, and we don't have to worry about the fire department. I think that what we need to do is work together as partners and come up with solutions. If we say we will help up until June, July 1st, we need to sit down and compromise and decide what we can do as partners to come up with grants. We live in a city where we have the border. We don't have a grant writer, but we're willing. If you do have a grant writer, we are a special district, and we can. I am sure that we can get money out there to help with the fire department. But we need you to assist as a partner. It's like we're going to go into business with you, and yet you're not giving us anything back in return.
Have a reserve.
It is just or the police department, or Parks and Recreation. The problem is collectively handling or mishandling of city funds and how we're going to fix them in the near future, and so it doesn't happen again year upon year upon year, because it's not fair for them, it's not fair for us, it's not fair for anybody.
And I understand what you're telling me, Mr. Escobar, and I hate to say this, but we can only help the fire department because it's related to health. I wish that we could help you with all your other problems that you have, but that's why we keep on saying the fire department, because this is related to health, because we furnish the ambulance, and that's how we can help. I know that you have a lot of other problems. We're all aware of that.
Mr. Escobar brings out a very important point that we do have to collaborate and work together closely for the future. Mm-hmm. But right now, the focus is up until June 1st. How are we going to balance this deficit right now with the fire department? That's the first thing that we need to look at and come up with some solutions.
I think, Mr. Hodges, that as a board, if, let's say, you know, we do help out the city with this $568,000, right? Well, we don't want to come back here July 1st and be in the same spot. We want to work with you right now to see what we can do, you know, for next year, right? Ms. Bernal said it right now, you know, come back July 1st and start working on it, but I think we have to work on it right now, and not just with you, but with the fire department as well. You know, if you're negotiating with them, I don't know, the 30% cut or whatever, cut has to go, you know, work, but we have to work fast in these 3 months, right? Because the $168,000 are only going to cover us up to July 1st. So.
And I have a question. Did you look into the funds that Chief Mercado pointed out to you on your last meeting, Wednesday? And if so, can you tap into those monies?
You're referring to the state reimbursement?
Yes.
And
the funds that Mr. Mercado was talking last time, he was referring to mutual aid reimbursement from the state of California, but actually this money is what is spent in advance by the city. We paid overtime to, city pay overtime to the fire departments, and they say just reimbursement. So actually it's a wash. It's not extra funds to spend on. It's already credited to the department, fire department expenditures. So we don't have an extra money to come in to help with this situation. It's already accounted for or credited against the overtime expense during that time.
If I understand correctly, these firefighters went out to fight fires in other areas and were paid the overtime, the $230,000 that Mr. Chief Mercado said. So when they pay us back, it's a wash because we already spent it. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but the state pays for the overtime also, doesn't it?
That's correct. So, like I said, this is, you know, I wish this information would have been shared earlier, but I mean, some of the information that we're getting is not entirely accurate, and I can just say because the money that we receive is a reimbursement for our time out there. It's not only the time, but the expenses. So, if that money was allocated to cover the salaries that we already knew we were going to be short, this reimbursement is kind of unknown. We don't know if we're going to go to one fire, two fires, or 10 fires. And so that isn't a wash. And I can guarantee you it's not a wash because they cover a 10% administrative rate. They cover time and a half for our firefighters being out on the line. Plus they reimburse the equipment. On incidents that I'm on, I only get paid my normal rate here at the city, but I'm compensated portal to portal, which means from the time I get called until the time I come back. And so, you know, I know that that is not a wash. So that's not true. So whether those monies were received and allocated and applied towards that budgeting account, then that's probably what happened. But to say it's a wash, it's not. One of the things that I could lend a little bit of more information to, and I was kind of trying to come up with a game plan as to how to make sense of the healthcare district continue to assist the fire department in our expenses. And we understand that the nexus between the Heffernan Memorial Healthcare District and the community is that they're always trying to bridge the gap of some sort of health benefit to the community. And whether it's with buying us defibrillators, ambulance, even equipment that we need to perform our duties, or even community physical fitness improvements, there's always that nexus. The ambulance service itself with the city costs us about between $1.1 to $1.3 million to operate our ambulance. That's with our personnel, with our expenses, with all our materials and supplies, everything to operate that expense. The way we offset those year to year is kind of somewhat of a magical thing that happens, is that we have our revenues that we generate by building collection. The revenue collected is applied directly into the general fund that offsets the expenses of the operation. We have a third-party company that does the billing for us, and we figured out that's the best way to perform this duty, because it's a minimal percentage of what we collect. It doesn't really cover one full employee here if you look at the fully burdened rate. So a third-party company collects our revenues. The revenues that we receive don't really offset, a wash for the expenses. So there's about a $600,000 to $700,000 loss every year. Now, the reason that we've reached out to the Heffernan Board on multiple years is because of some of the shortfalls for equipment. And some of the shortfalls for equipment are usually spent out of our general fund. So how do we make it work? Well, buy us defibrillators or equipment. That's something less that I have to spend out of our general fund to purchase. And you know, the math is a little bit too close to home when you start looking at the six members that we may have to lay off. For all firefighters, our ambulance is operated by six firefighters. The revenue that we collect every year has been decreasing every year. So when there's offsetting of purchases, we can make that work by receiving donations or receiving grants. And we've been very successful at receiving grants over the past number of years. But in the last 3 or 4 years, it's been very difficult for us to get any awards. And I don't know specifically what it is. I know it's not our grant writing, because we write our own grants in the fire department, but I just think that the explanations are very generic. I know a lot of them had to do with our financial reports, that we weren't had a single year audit for a number of years, and that was a deciding factor. But I think that when we operate that, is there's a coverage in our general fund that offsets some of those expenses. The problem that we're finding now is that our budgets have become extremely lean, and the added funds that we had for added equipment are no longer there. So we were facing some really difficult times, and I think that unfortunately we can't cover those expenses anymore. Before, the $400,000 that we might have been offsetting because of the expenses, we could have covered with not purchasing a set of equipment a year, or doing away with a little bit more of renovating of some of our facilities or replacing equipment. And the other thing too is that with the decreases in collection because of the restructuring of the Medicare private pay reimbursements, everyone in the industry has seen their revenues decrease. At one point, we were collecting close to $600,000 a year. This year, I think we're right about $450,000, or projected to be $450,000 by the end of the fiscal year. So that added, close to $200,000 is not there. All these little micro problems add up to why we're short. So I think that the Heffernan Board has always supported our medical response and our ambulance and our operation and our personnel. So it's always been a natural fit for us to try to do that. And I think that's very similar to what we're asking for today, is to just consider helping out any way you can to offset the expenses to close this gap, until we figure out where we sit financially, and those figures come back, and then we can sit back at the table and begin concessions, because Mr. Escobar, you know, nailed it, is that we need to fix the problem. We can't continue to operate in this, what if next year, and what if next year, and what after the year. We need to restructure, we need to reorganize the way we do business. And it's gonna take that restructuring to just figure out what the problems are. We need to figure it out from the core, and that's kind of what we need to do. So I don't have the solutions right now, but I think that collaboratively with the city manager, we can work together as a team to figure out how we're gonna be able to close this gap for future endeavors and make it work for the community.
I want to tell you that Dr. Edward was supposed to be here today. He's a CEO from El Centro Regional, but he went back to Texas because it's his 25th anniversary, but he really wanted to be here. And Mrs. Romo, I don't know if you remember the last time that we met with Dr. Edward and we were on the speakerphone with you. Dr. Edward mentioned that there's funds out there for when people that can't pay, there's grants out there. This man is very knowledgeable, and I'm really ashamed that I'm really sorry that he's not here today, because he would have been able to tell you all this information. But I do think that if we sit down with him and discuss some of those grants that he's talking about, that would cover for those people that can't afford to pay for their ambulance services, that would also help a lot.
You know, I agree. I think that there's a bunch of untapped medical resources that we just don't have access to. Unfortunately, my department is an administration of one. It's me. And I don't have a couple of mid-level managers to help me out. The people that help me out are my supervisors, who are also out there handling calls. So there's a lack of, you know, I can't be everywhere at one time. And we do the best with what we have. And unfortunately, that's not to make excuses. But I think that's definitely a lot of light to shed on the situation, where we can maybe tap into their resources. And they have more avenues for gaining some of our collections that we're missing, you know, because we farm it out. And you know, maybe we can utilize some collaboration with the hospital boards to better utilize their resources to help us increase our revenues.
And it's to the El Centro Regional's benefit, because you take all the patients over there. Whatever we decide to do today, I think that I would be willing to help, and so with the rest of the board members, to set up a meeting so that you can meet with Dr. Edward and we can go over some of the grants that we can do together with the Hefferman board and the fire department to be able to get some money to pay for those that can't afford to pay.
Yeah, no, I think that's a great idea. And, you know, you brought up a really good point, Sylvia, in that, you know, when we purchased our defibrillators, the reason we chose that model was because the El Centro Regional was utilizing that same model. And so the intercommunication, the Bluetooth capability, the on and on. Just the other day when their monitors went down and we had to lend them one of ours, which is compatible to their system, which was compatible to everything, and we didn't lose any interactive between the field and the receiving hospital. So that's the Heffernan board at work, and I think that's what we need to continue to do.
Thank you. So, at this point in time, what is the wishes of the Heffernan board?
We heard, aside from Mr. Mercado, I heard Mr. Bredesen, and I know that according to what we do, Heffernan dedicated to wellness and health in the community, fire department, I don't see why not to help at least to cover that gap and make a motion at least for those 4 months, and then we'll see what happens in the next fiscal year. First, God, we'll see. But I would like to make a motion.
Okay, there's a motion on the floor by Mrs. Apodaca to go ahead and approve the $568,000, $224 to the fire department. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Mr. Valdez. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Aye. Motion carries. Congratulations, fire department. So that just means that the fire department and us and the city, we will be working together really close, because there are grants out there. I know there's grants. As Mr. Edward was saying, there's a lot of grants, because We have the highest rate of unemployment. We have all kinds of illnesses, and we're a border town. There's a lot of grants, and it's like Mr. Mercado was saying, he doesn't have the time to do it, but if all of us collaborate together, we will be able to find ways to get money.
Good.
Work together. Yes. Yeah, collaborating. So thank you. Excuse me? Yeah. Yeah. Does the city have a grant writer?
I
have several.
I've asked for one, but we don't. Well, I mean.
Yeah. I just want to say thank you to the Heffernan Board for your efforts. And obviously in the conversation today, we realize that we do have a community with very vulnerable residents, low-income individuals who are elderly and cannot take care of themselves, living alone, and single parents and children and things like that. So I think that if we do not work this hard in combination with the other agencies that are in Calexico, we're leaving our very most vulnerable people out there to fend for themselves, and we just can't do that. So it has to take this type of work, and I'm very thankful to all of you. Glad that we're working together it's been a while, but this is what we had to do, and we will continue to do. So thank you so much for your efforts.
Yes.
We do have some public comments.
On item.
Norma Aguilar, 839 Heber Avenue. First of all, thank you, Heffernan Board, for stepping up to the plate and recognizing that this is a vital and necessary service to our community because, for example, today we had a state of emergency in our city where there was a shooting across town and there was delayed in traffic. So I don't know the outcome of the whole, whether there was injuries, but it's those type of situations that can come up, and thank you for stepping up to the plate. I also want to concur with your statement in regards to the need for a grant writer. I've done some research in terms of the grants available. There's some grants available through FEMA and through and specifically for to helping fire departments cover lack of staffing or funding. So there is money out there, not just on a federal but also a state level. And as you mentioned, I think maybe those other grants are related specifically to medical. I want to suggest something. I've suggested it to individuals before, but maybe putting it out here gets minds going and so forth. You have an invaluable resource right next door. You've got students that are in their senior years that have to do internships. You have public administration seniors. You have criminal justice seniors. Why not tap in? Why not work with the university? I'm not speaking on behalf of the university. I'm a counselor there, and I can point out to you that there are students that are bright, that do excellent research. Why not tap into that to help research for grants, to research for, obviously not this right this moment, but looking into the future. You have untapped resources that you're not able to get. For example, there's businesses downtown that we know are not following and giving receipts. What about having criminal justice students help you enforce that? Or working with your departments that enforce code? There's examples. Public administration in terms of helping run the day-to-day operations. There's a lot of resources out there. And I bet you that if you called out and said, hey, is anybody willing to work with us to work on grants? They do it. I would volunteer. So it's out there. Thank you.
Hi, Curtis Escalante, former fire chief, 2007, retired. I just have to applaud the Heffernan Board and coming up to the plate and getting the home run. But I want to know what the city council is going to do now. that they're going to accept what the Heffernan Board did?
That's what I was just asking, Mr. Hodge, City Attorney. Is there a motion that the City Council would need to entertain in order to receive the grant formally?
Do I have to come back later on and accept it, or is the next meeting, or?
She's going to officially answer.
I think that the city should accept our grant. We will prepare a very simple grant agreement, just like we did for the equipment park and concrete for the walking track over at the Socos Park. The city and the district have entered into a grant agreement. Very simple. We would like the council to also approve accepting.
Mr. Mayor, I would entertain then a motion, if I may, to accept the grant offer just stated now by the Heffernan Board.
Can we get a response from our city attorney?
Sure.
Ceremonial, I guess. I'll second that motion. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I have another question. So the guys are going to get the letters, they don't have to worry anymore? I want to make sure. I mean, they're not going to be harassed anymore.
Oh, we're talking about, is that closed session? You want to speak on that? Or? Closed session.
Well, I just want to say.
We can't.
I just want to say that is one of the reasons that we are here, the board is here.
I understand that. Like I said, I applaud that, but I just want to make sure the guys are all happy right now, and I'm happy too, and so is the crowd. But are we going to have to come back tomorrow and find out?
It appears at least here.
The proposed grant agreement is going to be a part of Heffernan. It's going to be prepared where the funds are going to be used specifically for the $562,000 deficit, which represents, according to the city, the six firefighters and the closure.
Yes.
So that will be in the grant agreement.
Okay.
Hopefully that is what we'll
okay.
It's going to be
discussed in executive session.
Closed session, formalized.
One more thing, I'd like to applaud also the City Council for getting here and doing something about it. The last council meeting I wasn't able to attend, but I spent 3 hours on my cell phone watching it. And my God, I mean, everybody was waiting, every place else. But together, you're together with the Heffernan Board and yourselves, and you're doing something that's right for the City of Calexico and right for everybody that comes to Calexico. We have the greatest fire department. I stood by that fire department when I was working there, and I stand by it today. It's the best fire department in the valley. Thank you.
I agree.
Mr. Felix? Is he the last one? Yeah.
City Council, Heffernan Board, thank you. I just want to put the record straight. We are paying 20% of our insurance. We started 4 years ago. We're the only ones. So by saying we're not negotiating in good faith, it's false. We are, and we're ready to negotiate. So don't think we're not. We're paying 20%, started 4 years ago. Thank you.
Thank you.
My name is John Kim, former council member. I'm sad to hear standing here because when I was council, when we were talking about discussion about the negotiations, we need to have a cut. I instructed the city manager saying, fire department, we don't have much issues. In case of if we need it, we can go ask the happen on board. And city manager asked me, do you want me to go ask them? I told him to go to happen on board to ask if we need the money for the fire departments. It didn't happen. And we could save a lot of issues with the community, angers. It could be a lot better, look better. And even that, they were, what I'm saying, is, what I said, it because we have a paramedic, but we have entitled to have the money from the Heffernan board, I believe they will do it. And look at this happens. Thank you for the Heffernan board.
Before we leave, I just want to tell the City Council that this is the first time that the Heffernan Board, in all the years that it's been in existence, has had a joint meeting. And I hope that it's not the last one. I think that we need to do it at least yearly so we can come together and decide what things need to be done.
I agree. That's a great idea.
So I hope this is the beginning of something. Thank you.
Motion to adjourn.
Okay.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
We will convene to a closed session.